What's up? This is Rebel Radio.
What up? What up? This is DJ Newmark.
This is Peanut Butter Wolf.
It's your boy. It's okay.
Keep checking out Rebel Radio.
Rebel Radio.
This is Rebel Radio.
We're in the place right here. Rebel Radio is going down.
Would you say Rebel Radio?
Oh, wait. Let's do it again.
Rebel Radio.
What's up, Rebels? Welcome back to Rebel Radio, the weekly show where I talk to the rebels who are shaping youth culture. We find out how they do it, why they do it, and what you can do to get a little piece of the pie for yourself. We're also the only show that features new music every week from our friends over at EDM.com. I'm your host, Josh Levine. My guest this week is the one and only Rude Jude. I want to warn you, there's a lot of cuss words in this episode. If you are offended by that, you're probably not listening anyway, but you might want to skip this one. I hope you don't, though, because it's a great interview. Rude Jude was on our show a couple years ago, and that episode is our number one most popular episode of all time. So this is going to be a good one too, for sure. I'm excited to have him back. He's the author of a new book called Hummingbird, which features stories from his life. I strongly encourage you to get that book and check it out. Get the audiobook. Listen to Jude read it in its own voice. It's pretty amazing. We get into some crazy discussions, stories from the book. We talk about politics. We get into some unfortunate areas where I think we disagreed, and it's not really the stuff I want to talk about on the show. But one thing, if you know Rude Jude, is that you're not in control of him. He's going to take over and talk about whatever he wants, which is why I love talking to him. It's really good stuff coming up on Rebel Radio with Rude Jude right after our EDM.com track of the week.
Yeah, champagne bottles in the room, twist it. I ain't drinking that though, I'm drinking some whiskey.
Yo, that was Mr. Nichols with a track called Good Pussy, the EDM.com track of the week. If you like that one, get over to EDM.com, check out new music, and let's get into our interview right now with Rude Jude.
Cool. Man, thanks for coming back to do this.
Yeah.
I think I told you on the phone, our first, you know, the interview you did has been our number one bestseller since we started. I don't know why, but, you know, people love hearing your voice, I guess.
I'll take it.
For sure.
I'll take it.
And so I know when you were back, when you were here originally, I think Hyena had just come out.
Yeah.
And so we were talking about that, and now you have a new book, Hummingbird.
Correct.
Which I just finished listening to. I do Audible. They're a sponsor of the show, but that's not why we're talking about them. But
yeah.
But the hearing you read your own writing is incredible.
Thank you, man.
And it's definitely one of my favorite things I've read recently.
It's fucking, yo, first, doing your own reading what you wrote is hard as hell.
Yeah.
I think every author should do the audiobook before it goes into print.
Yeah.
That way you can hear the sentences that sound clunky, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
There was a couple of ones in there, I was like, oh, I wish I would have wrote that differently.
Is that right?
Fuck yeah, dude. It's hard to say out loud.
I'm sure because your stories are so personal and
yeah.
Some of them, you know, I'm sure were really painful.
Yeah.
And so reading it, but you have this interesting way about you that there's like, there's a certain amount of detachment that you can hear.
Yeah.
Right? Like it doesn't feel like you're talking. In the sense of like, I don't know how to explain it. Like it, in a good way, like it makes it easier to listen to the story as a story.
Right.
As opposed to just hearing you talk about like some of these fucked up things that happened or whatever.
Yeah, it's written, it's prose.
Yeah.
So it sounds like how I would talk, but it's not how I would talk, I guess is the best way to
put
it. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
So one of the things I noticed, and I want to talk about for a minute, you mentioned music, like, at different points in the book. Like, I put on this record.
Right.
I forget what some of them were, but it stood out to me because, you know, you're on a hip-hop station.
Right.
Shade 45, and you host a show that's, you know, I think of you as a hip-hop guy.
Yeah.
I know that's an oversimplification. And then most of the references were, like, classic rock, or I think there was some jazz or different stuff. What's been your journey musically? Like, do you remember the first music that you heard and fell in love with?
It was rap. I grew up around rap. Yeah. You know what I mean? It was like that was my neighborhood. My neighborhood was rap. I came from a neighborhood that played rap music.
What's the song that comes to mind as like the first thing?
I don't know, The Message or fucking Electric Kingdom or even Kraftwerk or something like that. Rappin' Duke, Sugar Hill Gang. These are all off the top of my head. Lottie Dottie.
Yep.
6 minutes, Dougie Fresh, you're on. Like that. That was like the stuff I grew up on.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like the other thing. What for? Not to knock other fucking. Not to knock anybody. But like this wasn't like my big brother played at AAU and was friends with a black kid
and then
that black kid gave him EPMD and now he's listening to that. No, this is what I grew up with.
Yeah.
Like this is where I came from. So rap was what I grew up on. And back in the day, like you couldn't listen to other music.
Right.
You was like, it wasn't like, I like rap and I like The Cure.
Right.
You like rap.
They didn't go together.
I was strictly hip hop for fucking years.
Yeah.
But my sister listened to alternative shit.
Okay.
My mom had a broad taste in music, you know, anything from XTC to Bob Marley to the Spasmatics or Plasmatics, I don't know. I don't remember the name. I just remember the cover. It was like a naked chick, which I thought was cool. And then my old man listened to everything from like, you know, Willie Nelson to the Eagles to the Beatles.
Yeah. It's funny. So I had a similar, I think we grew up
same
in a lot of ways. I don't know, some stuff we'll talk about off the air.
Right.
But you know, and I'm a little bit older than you, I think. So somebody had asked me the same thing about how I got into hip hop. And for me, it was like the neighborhood. It was, so this is 70s before hip hop, right? We were listening to Kool & the Gang, Gap Band, you know, Earth, Wind & Fire.
Right.
And then, but it was all black music. And then that became hip hop.
Yes.
You know, and then one day, Rapper's Delight came on. And then all of us that were like, it just, you just migrated.
It just made sense. Knowing it. Yeah, you're like, you know, damn, this is all right.
And it wasn't until I was this one kid in the sixth grade, and you know, it was like, oh, what you into? And I was like, you know, that's soul shit, whatever.
All right.
Which to me included
rap. Yeah.
And he was like, oh, I don't fuck with that. I fuck with rap.
See, that's the weird thing for me, because like we still listen to you. It was the same deal. It wasn't like I didn't listen to Troop.
Right.
You know what I mean? I still stayed listening to fucking Keith Sweat and shit, and Johnny Gill and New Edition. And
but this is, you know, we're 11 years old, right?
Yeah.
So you oversimplified things.
Yes.
Right. And so now I'm the same way. I'm as likely to put on a hip hop record as I am classic rock or a, you know, not country, but pretty much anything else.
Right.
But it took a long time to be like, for that to be okay.
Yeah, it's weird. I was like, I think I was in my early 20s when I finally, my buddy said it in a nice way. He was like, man, here I am, this giant record store, and I'm just in this section.
Right.
And that really made sense to me. And I started branching out. I think some of my first, like the first rock shit that I actually bought was like, it was, I think, my Animals. My dad put me on to House of the Rising Sun. Mm-hmm. And then I went over to, like, the White Stripes and the Stooges. And it grew from there. And it was funny, man. Like, certain shit, I couldn't even listen to at first because I was like, ugh, this isn't, this is not for me.
Yeah,
I had to have gateway
for sure.
bands to get me to, like, Lynyrd Skynyrd. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, Skynyrd was cool, but, like, I had to hear three other bands first to really get Skynyrd, you know, like I'm like, yeah, I fuck with Skynyrd now.
Yeah.
I listen to all that shit. And I listen to country. Like I got a whole box of country. I like George Jones is my fucking man, dude.
Okay.
I love George Jones. Yeah, look, man, that's, you know, a lot of cats don't like it because tonally it's twangy to them.
Right.
But like, yo, that's redneck hood shit, bro.
For sure.
Like they sing about some real ass shit that I could relate to.
Mm-hmm.
George Jones is crazy too, cause like you can't listen to more than three of his songs without wanting to kill yourself. You're like, fuck, dude, this is.
Is that right?
Oh, bro, yeah, man. He stopped loving. He's got a song. He stopped loving her today. It's all about how he stopped loving his girl that day, and that day was the day he died. Cause she broke up with him.
Right.
Like he stopped loving her today. You find out he's dead. The last verse.
That's crazy.
I mean, yeah. It's like one of the saddest. It's rated like one of the saddest songs of all time. That shit fucking kills you, man.
Right.
Everybody can relate to that. Everybody can relate to like. Well, not everybody, but a lot of people can relate to fucking losing someone and just never.
For sure.
Never getting over them, man. Fuck you up, man.
Yeah.
And I think that's a cool thing about a lot of soul and country and even rap to a certain extent.
Yeah.
If they want to go that route. Mm-hmm. That's why Pac speaks to me. That's why Scarface speaks to me.
Yeah.
Even, I was going to say Jay-Z album cuts, but sometimes I don't know if he's all the way sincere. You know what I mean?
Yeah. There's a certain, you kind of can see the role that he's playing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And if anything, like, he's living it now.
Right.
And he was talking about it back then.
Yeah, like, you know? And you must love me, that you must love me song, where he's talking about selling, shooting his brother and selling dope to his kinfolk. I'm just like, how bad do you really feel about that? Do you feel that bad about it, or are you just saying it because you're supposed to feel bad about it?
Yeah, I mean, even the lemonade shit, it's like, you know, let me go ahead and profit off of my marital problem.
He seems a bit calculated, and I don't fault the dude, but like...
It works.
It doesn't... Some songs I really fuck with, but like I'm a fan of Jay-Z. I'm just saying as far as like fucking that emotional vulnerability, Face and Pac and even M are like the fucking...
Yeah.
I think those guys are the standards. And then you get into people like Atmosphere where you're like, now it just sounds like you're jerking off into a fucking Kleenex and you're crying like, and it seems a bit indulgent. So...
Well, it's funny. So like, we could talk about this because, you know, coming from where we came from, right?
Yeah.
Where, you know, you're a white kid in a predominantly black environment. Right?
Yes.
I mean, I grew up in San Francisco. It was very mixed, but still. Right.
It was mixed too where I was from, too, man. Sure. It was a little bit of everything.
Right.
It was more poor, you know, like that was a tax bracket of being broke.
Yeah. Same here. Yeah. And at the same time where hip hop was, even being a hip hop fan at all, you were an outlier.
Yeah.
No matter what color your skin was, right? Mm-hmm. Just because hip hop had not become this mainstream thing.
No, it was underculture.
Yeah.
Subculture.
And then, so, you know, and I always blame Eminem for this, although blame is not really the right word, right? But he showed the world that you didn't have to be, well, he showed the world that you could be white and still be a great rapper.
Right.
Although there were some before him.
Beastie Boys would be the obvious.
Yeah. But I feel like this light turned on for white kids around the world. Atmosphere, like a whole generation of guys after M who were just like, oh, okay, I can see myself in that role now.
Do you think it's because he had, and I don't necessarily know if I even agree with that statement, but like, but let's dig into that. Do you think it's because his success was so big, it reached so many people that...
I think it was partly that.
And rap was much bigger then.
Right. So a lot of it was timing, right? It was where the world was at.
And
I mean,
Andy was the best rapper.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, hey man, this guy's pretty good. He was rapping circles around anybody out at that time coming out just...
Yeah.
And yo, I'm going to tell you something else. I think his whiteness really fucking helped culturally.
Right.
Because he was able to be self-deprecating in a way.
He
didn't take himself too as serious as other rappers, and I think that a lot of times that has to do with being able to fucking laugh at yourself. And some of these guys are too tough to be able to laugh at themselves.
Yeah, no question.
He was able to find his lane.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, I think the. You know, I remember. So I met M. You know, at the time I was a manager.
Yeah.
And the kid that worked for me had kind of discovered M. at Interscope and had left and was working for me, and he was trying to set me up with a meeting to talk about management.
Right.
And I was like, yeah, that demo is cool, but a white rapper is not going to happen. And I just blew it off.
Right. People don't remember, like, they don't, like, young kids don't even understand that shit.
Right.
Like, the fucking doors that he had fucking kicked down.
For sure. And I didn't get it. Not that I didn't get him.
Right.
I didn't get it as a marketable act.
Right.
And so I didn't take it seriously and whatever. But what I was going to say is, you know, there was a whole generation of suburban white kids at that time who were defining their lives around hip hop.
Yes.
Right. They were, and you mentioned it in one of the stories. You mentioned it on Asa Akira podcast that, like, when you're the white guy who gets hip hop, like, you want to be the only one.
Yeah, you don't trust. You're distrustful of another Caucasian.
Yeah.
That you're like, oh, I'm the only real motherfucker. I'm right. Like, oh, but like that, you know.
But there was a generation of those kids, right, who were all feeling that way. And that's where I feel like Eminem, like, turned on the lights for those guys.
Right.
That, like, you could be that, and you could kind of own that. And so that's where I feel that sort of proliferated in terms of cats making music.
Yeah, maybe. And look, also, it's also what the market dictates.
For sure.
Shit.
Yeah, all of a sudden
labels are fucking pussies. Yeah. Like, let's be real. Like, labels are pussies. They're scared.
Yeah.
They don't take chances.
Yeah, they need somebody else to show them.
Yeah, they need, like, yo, yeah. There might have been a gang of fucking white rappers that could spit that weren't getting a chance.
Absolutely.
And then M comes down, kicks down the fucking door. And, you know, rap was getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
You had albums going platinum for fucking 5, 6, 7, 8 years before, like, Chronic went platinum, fucking NWA went platinum. I remember EPMD. Remember they was rapping about their shit and going gold?
Right.
You mean, like, that was a big accomplishment?
Yeah, for sure.
These are baby steps. And that's
for
the
sure.
shit that kills me about this new rap. It's like, yo, dude, like, congratulations to you, whatever, but just realize that you're standing on the shoulders of giants. It took so many people to fucking build this shit for you. And now, yo, get your fucking money, but, like, be grateful. Be thankful.
Well, it's an interesting conversation because... you know, so Quincy Jones just put that interview out.
Yeah, he was going in on everybody,
dude,
bro.
That was amazing.
I love that shit. I disagree with the Beatles.
Oh, I disagree with...
I love the Beatles.
I disagree with the Michael Jackson. Oh, the Bruno Mars.
All right, what did he say about Bruno Mars?
He said Bruno Mars is one of the guys making great pop music today.
I think Bruno Mars is derivative as fuck.
As fuck, right?
Oh, like, and if I want to hear the Police, I'll go listen to the Police.
How
I
Quincy
hear
does
Daz
he,
Band, I'll go listen to fucking Daz Band.
Exactly. How Quincy doesn't see that, it confuses me. And then he also accuses Michael of stealing this Donna Summer song.
Right.
I listened to the Donna Summer song, and I like Donna Summer. This song is garbage from start to finish.
Right.
It has no resemblance to Billie Jean. But
that doesn't mean that Mike didn't take from
maybe
other
he did.
People.
And
yeah.
I think if he did, he was doing her a favor, because that's something good came out of that song.
Yes. I haven't heard that song, so I can't comment.
It's
one
in
way
the
or
link.
Another.
Like, it links in the article to the song, and the song's terrible. All respect to Donna Summer. It's just
I
a
love
bad
Donna
song.
Summer, by the way.
No,
on
I
the radio,
too.
That's
I
my
too,
shit.
But it's a bad song.
All right.
I forget the name of it.
I don't know. I'm not going to comment on Donna Summer's. I love that. I love that woman. Go, keep going.
Anyway, so I disagree with certain things in the article, but it's. Mostly, it's incredible that he's saying all this shit.
Yeah, like, look, man, we can't take... It's one man's fucking opinion. This isn't, like, the fucking gospel.
No, of course.
So it's just, like, you listen to him and then you fucking decide what you want to decide.
Of course. But he says what you just said, right, which is that young artists, the producers, he's really critical of producers, that they need to know their history. And he kind of oversimplifies, I think, what's wrong with modern music, which is that producers don't know the history. Right, they didn't go back and understand what got them there, what got us to this point, which is kind of what you're saying about these young rappers.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's an interesting, like, I agree, but it's also maybe too much to expect of people.
I can agree to that to a certain extent. Look, the books I write would be put in the same category as beat writer shit.
Right.
I respect beat writers. I understand, like, Kerouac. I try to read on the road. It's not my thing. But I understand, I have respect for Jack Kerouac. I understand that that was the thing that sparked this giant fucking thing.
Right.
You know, Fonte and fucking Bukowski and Miller and all these other cats. I don't read them.
Right.
Because I don't want to bite off of them.
Right.
But I respect them.
Yeah.
I'm not dismissing them. Like, there's a reason why I like Westerns and fucking medieval shit.
Right.
And, like, that's what I go towards.
Right.
But, like, I'm not going to be like, you're not going to hear me sitting here saying, fuck Bukowski.
Right. Yeah, of course.
Even if he's not my taste, I'm not going to say that shit, because if it wasn't for Bukowski, I wouldn't fucking be writing the way I'm writing, whether I like it or not.
But you also don't have Bukowski saying, Rude Jude is full of shit, he doesn't know what he's doing, right?
Well, I got worse. I'm ignored by the literati.
Fair enough.
Like, I would love for a fucking author to fucking call me out so we can have a fucking discussion and go we'll go sentence for sentence.
Okay.
I would love for that.
Yeah.
But I'm ignored. Like, I'm ignored. I'm having problems getting into bookstores.
Is that right?
Fuck yeah.
Why?
I'm not famous enough.
Okay.
I'm not what they're looking for.
Right.
As in I am not what the literati is looking for. And I didn't go to college, so I don't have the fucking college connections either. They don't know what the fuck to do with me. I'm not technically a writer in their eyes. I'm not technically a fucking celebrity. And I'm not a fucking lesbian, fucking transsexual immigrant that wants to tell their story. And right now, that's kind of what the literati is fucking jerking off to. I don't know if you noticed that shit.
No, so I haven't, because I think...
How many books like mine do you see out?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I mean, I read, you know, I find books almost exclusively on Amazon and Audible.
Right, right, right.
Right. You know, once in a while I'll hear about something, you know, like somebody will tell me about a book or whatever.
Right, right.
But, you know, I can't think of the last time I was in a bookstore. Right. And I think that, so I get your point, but at the same time, like I don't know what's showing at LACMA right now. But I know that I fuck with Shepard Fairey, and I fuck with Chase in Venice, and I fuck with Retina, and like those are the artists.
And those are the guys that gotta go. That's the thing. They're just going around. They're going around the fucking people, and that's what I'm doing. But like what I'm saying is, like, I'm just trying to set up fucking signings.
Right.
My signings blow out all of their signings.
But that's what I'm saying, right?
The little hoe ass signings.
I'm just saying that
fucking the 12 people showing up ass motherfuckers.
What I'm saying, that traditional channel might not be for you, but you might, and I get why, if you're in that position, that's frustrating, but at the same time, I think you don't even need them.
Yes and no. Yes and no. You do need them to get on, you know, like New York Times bestseller is not just the best-selling book.
Sure.
And that does help with fucking things.
Yeah, of course.
And unfortunately, I have a diehard fan base, but I also, my fan base is a fan base that doesn't, they don't read.
Right.
So there you go. Like, I'm trying to sell, exercise equipment to fat people. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I'm like, hey, fat ass, you want this gluten-free fucking cookie? And no one wants to have a gluten-free fucking cookie. And that's not all of.
No,
I'm not here to fucking bitch about what it is. It is what the fuck it is.
Right.
But I'm also completely aware of what the fuck it is. And what it is some bullshit, and I just got to work around it.
So how, I want to talk about the writing first.
Yeah.
Even though we're talking about kind of marketing.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
How is the second book different from the first?
It's darker.
No, like, how is it for you different? Like, you had already written the first one, right?
Well, the first book is, like, for anyone that doesn't know, it's called Hyena.
Yeah.
It's like short stories, essays, just about like getting over a girl, and it's, you know, a lot of sex, drugs, introspection. It's not just fucking dick jokes. It's actually like got some fucking, it's got some heart in that bitch.
Yeah.
And the follow-up was, I was like, all right, man, like, I can't be fucking Hyena 2. just got to get a little bit deeper and go in a different direction. I was just at a different place in my life. I basically, you know, the first book was very successful, and here I was still fucking miserable doing crazy shit. You know, I just started writing again. And this one really addresses, I was tired of hearing about the victim mentality. I was tired of hearing about bullying. I was tired of seeing these fucking 20-year-old, I was tired of seeing 20-year-old infants still being taken care of by their parents. Mm-hmm. And this, and I don't really say any of this directly. I just talk about it in stories, and either you get it or you don't.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are actually kind of picking up on that shit.
I'm sure.
It's like, yo, dude, like, own your shit, boss up, be a fucking man. If you're a piece of shit, acknowledge it. Mm. I'm not even telling you to stop. I'm just saying realize, like, you know, self-realization. Talk about sacrifice. Everybody wants everything for free.
Yeah.
Like, everything costs, bro. Ain't nothing free in this fucking world, man.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing free. Someone sends you a free something, they want something back. Even if that's fucking your fucking correspondence.
Yeah,
like,
your attention.
Yeah. Ain't nothing free in this fucking world, man. So, like, these are things that I'm just trying to fucking... Even like you kids living at home, like getting taken care of by your parents. You think you're free, you're not free. Mm. You're sacrificing your freedom for a fucking cell phone. You get a car ticket, you get a ticket.
Right.
You gotta call mom and dad and explain that shit. I don't gotta do that.
Yeah.
I'm a fucking man. And I'm just encouraging fucking, like, why don't you young motherfuckers grow up and be fucking, just grow up. I'm looking at a bunch of 30-year-old toddlers. It's fucking annoying. I gotta live next to them.
Yeah, I'm sure. So, you know, it's interesting you say that because I think, you know, we're in the space between your two books, our awareness of all that has changed.
It's gotten different.
Yeah.
It's really changed.
And, you know, you talk a lot about race, obviously, in the books through your own experience.
Yes.
I think our... relationship. I don't think racism's changed. I think our relationship to racism has changed.
I think, well, first off, racism is a human condition.
Yeah.
So this idea that only white people can be racist, I find to be fucking, it's a stupid idea. And it takes fucking your, it makes it, a minority fucking arguing that point makes you sound weak. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, you're not as good as me.
Right.
You are not as good as you are. You're by not owning that shit, you're saying that you're not my equal and that you should not be held to my standards. Mm-hmm. And as men, we should all be held to the same standards. So, you know, look, man, racism is racism. Tribalism is tribalism. At the end of the day, I don't care what the fuck you think. It's what do you do? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not trying to be thought police. Mm-hmm. Are you not hiring me because of my fucking race?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you don't gotta like me.
Right.
You don't gotta, look at the rap community. It's a contentious relationship between black people and Jewish people.
For sure.
And they work side by side to get that motherfucking money.
Absolutely.
So it's like, yo, dude, like, hey,
yeah.
We don't need to like each other per se. We need to fucking respect each other as men, you know, and fucking deal with one another. And so, like, I'm not trying to solve fucking racism.
Right.
I was just tired of this fucking tired ass narrative that's been going on for the last fucking 7-8 years with identity politics, people misusing statistics.
Right. Yeah.
Misquoting facts to push their agenda.
So does that change things for you? Like, you know, again, you've always been, you know, outspoken. You know, you've always said things that are kind of taboo. Like, we see all these politicians and...
Have,
you know,
I stopped saying what I used to say?
No. Are people reacting differently because of this environment that we're in today?
Yeah. People are more... Within the last 5 years, people have become more sensitive.
Yeah.
Hands down. And because of that, I stopped. I don't get raises, like, based on, you know, like, I'm not getting paid more for fucking talking about this shit.
Right.
It's agita.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck do I care?
Right.
Believe your stupid fucking belief.
Yeah.
Have you
changed your the way you do things?
I don't talk race and politics.
Right.
Like, you want to talk race and politics, there's a thousand other channels.
What about gender?
Gender, I'll speak on, but even that, like, I don't go super in. Like, that wage gap shit is fucking bullshit. Go look it up.
Yeah.
Just go look it up. Fucking economists are shitting all over that fucking thing.
I had the same conversation. Like, my buddy teaches economics. I was having the exact same conversation with him yesterday.
Yeah, fucking, you want to talk about, you know, like, I think we all agree that fucking a child needs a mom and a dad, yet mm-hmm. fucking over 80% of fucking custody goes to women.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these are fucking facts, dog. Like, these are facts. So, like, hey, I think men need to fucking unify, and I think if women really gave a fuck about the future, they would fucking be on board as well. But I don't think that people that are pushing the modern day feminist agenda really care about equality. I think they're using that to get power.
Yeah, to take something back.
Not even take something back. They're already winning.
Fair enough.
You have a higher fucking. There's more women in college.
Right. Live longer.
Less suicide rate.
Yeah.
90% of the deaths on the job are men.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hear, oh, there's not enough women CEOs. There's not enough women fucking roofers either. Is there? I don't hear you fucking crying about that.
That's right.
Like, yo, dude, like, I don't, yo whatever you want to do, you can do it. Ain't no one stopping you.
Yeah.
Like, I look at, and I hear these people crying, and I'm just like, think, and I keep saying this over and over. Think about your great-grandparents. Think about your grandparents. Would your grandparents be talking that shit, or would they be going to get that shit? I guarantee you, they'd be fucking getting it. My grandparents are tough.
You know, it's interesting you say that because, like on this show, I try to understand why certain people are successful, right?
Okay.
Like why, you know, we try to dig into like what makes creative people successful, what they do. And the one thing I've learned is that it's a little bit unique for everybody.
Is there any, do you find that there is any fucking like, okay, this guy, like, this is just a constant. This is a constant for everybody. Everybody does this one thing. Because I would love to know so I can start doing that shit.
Not really. If there is one, it's just not giving up.
Is it IQ? Is it intelligence? Is it fucking drive? Is it?
Yeah,
what
drive,
it?
but it's not giving up.
Persistence.
Yeah.
It's persistence.
That's the one thing that I think is the common thread. But other than that, like, some people are doing it by getting famous. Other people are not. Some people are doing one thing and shutting everything else out. Other people are, you know, got a bunch of hustles.
I mean, by getting famous, like, if by getting famous was easy, everybody fucking famous.
I'm not saying any of it's easy. I'm just saying some people are, like, you know, there's some, I know DJs that you've never heard of that get paid a lot of money to play corporate parties, right?
Smart.
They're not building their Instagram and all that in order to get booked at Vegas. Mm-hmm. They got this one lane that they want to play in, and they get to know these buyers, and they schmooze them, and they do whatever, and that's their hustle, right?
Yep.
That works for a certain type of dude. Because you have to have that personality, that mentality. You got to be a people person.
So I was building a relationship.
Right.
Okay.
With, you know, with 50 people that can make or break your career. And then there's the other guy who's trying to get as many Instagram followers as he can so that the dude in Vegas thinks he's going to sell bottles when they book him. That works for him. But that's his personality. You know what I mean? And so so the common thread, I think, and this is kind of back to what you were saying, is like, we each have our unique strengths and weaknesses.
Yes.
And so the good looking dude is going to have an easier time at some things, mm-hmm. maybe more things, but still some things. You know, see, like, hear comics talk about if you're too good looking, it works against you because the room wants to shit on you.
Yeah, it's like, who's this guy that's fucking can fuck my girlfriend?
Right.
And they're mad about it.
But the fat comic, we want to laugh at the fat guy, right?
Yes.
And so he's got a lane that's going to work for him. So that's all I'm saying is that is that the hustle is figuring out what's your lane that's going to work for you personally.
Yes.
Not trying to be somebody else.
Totally.
And realizing that the only way to do that is, one, to take responsibility for your own shit, right? And two, to not give up, because you're going to have to try stuff that doesn't work.
I'll give you one other thing, is to be able to look at yourself real, to, and it's, this is a hard thing to do, and this is something that I've struggled with, everybody struggles with. It's fucking being able to really take a long look at yourself and understand who and what you are. Yeah. It's amazing how many people live in denial. Like, I've been that guy, I've lived in denial on certain things. Everybody has a blind spot. The less blind spots you have, the better chance you have.
Can you take us to a moment when you've done that?
I'll tell you this. Can I get some water? I'll tell you, like, this is the one I go over time and time again. When I was on Jenny Jones, I had a girlfriend who I loved deeply. And we would go out to the club, and girls would run up on me and fucking, you know, hey Jude, and hug me and, mm-hmm. you know, box her out, you know, like all that, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'd be like, and I would allow it to happen. I was young. I would allow it to happen. And she would get mad at me for it. And I'd be like, man, you just jealous. You know, I'm going home with you. Like, right. I ain't going nowhere. I'm going home with you. I love you. I never cheated on her, ever. And I was like, you're just jealous. Like, you Arab. Right. I'm like, you Arab, you're tribal, you're jealous. I know y'all girls, you need to lighten the fuck up.
Right.
And it was fucking 10 years after we broke up, it dawned on me. It was like, she was right. Yeah. I shouldn't have been disrespectful to our relationship like that.
Yeah.
The fucking, the brutal, the hurtful fact was, I was so insecure that I needed everyone to love me. Mm-hmm. Her love was not enough.
Right.
So I needed everybody. I needed every girl in the bar to like me.
Yeah.
And that was one, you know, that wasn't the sole thing that cost our relationship, right. But that fucking fucked us up, dude.
Yeah.
But I would be like, nah, she's just jealous. I never could even see that part. It's painful to say I'm insecure.
Mm-hmm.
Damn, I feel fucked up about myself, and I'm willing to sacrifice that so I can get hugged by some fucking random girl. So that was my blind spot, and I've told that story before, but like, just off top, like, that was one of my blind spots.
I want to talk about Hummingbird a little bit. First of all, on Amazon, people that buy your book, they also buy Gucci Mane. That's like the number one thing that comes up, and that dude, the Australian dude that's on Sirius.
So it's showing you that I am doing quite well, but I'm selling to my audience.
Right.
So that's why I go on every podcast I can to expand my audience. Okay. Like, it's important for me to, look, that's why you do things, to grow. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I love my audience and I appreciate them.
I get it. You gotta grow.
It's for them too. Like, that book is for them. But yeah, it's like, I'm writing books for cats that don't read books.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean they're bad books, but I have those people in mind as I'm writing it.
Well, it's as you said, there's a structure that exists to direct readers to a certain type of book. Whether we agree that exists.
Totally, dude, right? All the way.
There's a lot. I imagine Gucci Mane's book probably doesn't fall into that category either.
Gucci Mane's weird. He's more of a celebrity than me, and he's a celebrity in hip hop. So therefore, people that listen to hip hop, I'm on a hip hop station, will buy my book and be like, ah, fuck it, I'll get that book too.
Yeah,
like, they're not dumb. They understand algorithms. Yeah,
for sure.
So that being said, the people that are buying my book, I'll say, you know, let's say 40% of them have not bought a book ever, or within the 10 years, they have not bought a book. Yeah. And if they have bought a book, it's been Hyena.
Yeah.
Like, these are fucking, a lot of these cats are blue collar dudes that just aren't reading a ton, man.
Yeah. One of my favorite stories, you talk about, you're 7 years old getting a beating from a kid that was your friend.
Yeah.
Y'all were playing.
Yeah.
And you end up trying to punch him in the dick. And like, first of all, I could not stop laughing. And you almost feel bad laughing.
No, it's like
it was hilarious.
That story touches on a couple things.
Yeah.
It touches on that, like, kids are fucking assholes. Yeah. We're always trying to establish a hierarchy.
Mm-hmm.
That one should stand up for themselves. Two, it was about feeling alienated and misunderstood.
Yeah.
And three, it was also about my relationship with the hippie side of my family, who detests, and you see it even more now, they detest masculinity.
Mm-hmm.
And they try to,
that's right,
they try to quell it. And anytime I showed any type of aggression at family functions,
mm-hmm,
or was too fucking loud or anything like that, I was shunned.
Yeah.
And that, I think that's bad to do to little boys. I think that's bad to do to boys.
Mm-hmm.
And in practice, it was awful because I was around a group of kids where it was like, yo, dude, boss the fuck. It was like tough kids. Right. I was around a bunch of tough kids and like, I'm over here trying to have a fucking intelligent discussion. Why do you feel this way? Blap, right. Blap, blap, get smacked in the head a couple of times. And that was like, that happened once. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like after that,
yeah,
like,
learned that.
No, actually it happened twice. I remember I was young, I was like this little kid, man, and this older girl just picked a booger and wiped it on my head, and I wanted to have a discussion with her about, why would you do this, da da da, and it's just like, my fucking hippie family, dude, like, what are you conditioning me for? And then, like, those two things happened, and, like, they weren't back-to-back, they weren't in the same week, but it was just like, why doesn't fucking matter?
Right.
Like, get that motherfucker off of you, dude.
Right.
Someone picks their booger and wipes it on your fucking head, and they're bigger than you, go pick up a fucking rock and hit them in the head with that shit, repeatedly. Like, and that is what you need, like,
right.
I condone violence.
Yeah.
I do. I'm not a fucking pass. I don't get in fights or anything like that, but like, yo, man, we have boundaries. Like, you do not be a doormat, because if you're a doormat here, and all you know is doormat, when you go to work, you're going to be a fucking doormat.
For sure.
You don't outgrow doormat.
Right.
You have to fucking fight your way out of doormat. And this is coming from somebody who has been a doormat, who has been a bully. And I think we all have been a doormat sometime in our life.
Of course. And a bully. And it's interesting because, you know, there's all this anti-bullying.
That was all a response to that, dude.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think, you know, for, you know, I've had those same kind of experiences. Right, and I remember, in that, especially in that age of elementary school, but it, you know, it went on where the bully, like, it's not the way it's kind of painted, like that there are these bullies and then there's the good people.
Yeah, right?
And I think it's like you would take turns, some more than others.
It's a weird but, hierarchical,
but your
pecking
friends
order
one
yeah
moment, and the next minute you're in a fucking fist fight.
Yep. And then you're homies again.
The dude's got you in a headlock, and you know, yeah,
half of my homeboys that I grew up half like I think every one of my friends that I grew up with, we got in a fist fight
for sure.
Like, that's just what the fuck it is. And it wasn't personal,
right?
Like,
yeah. But it's like playground rules.
Yeah, you just fucking, yo, after a while, like, you're going to punch me or I'm going to punch you. Like, there's only so much talking we're going to do.
Yeah.
No, I get it. Like, all right, you're 37 years old and you're out there fucking, you're at the bar fighting motherfuckers. Maybe you should take a look at yourself. Maybe you should take a long look at yourself. But
for
it's,
sure.
And here's the other thing, which was, I think we're in a culture now where failing is looked down upon worse than getting punked on.
Hmm.
So you see people less willing to stand up for themselves,
right?
Because they're afraid that they will fucking be made fun of, mm-hmm, for losing. Because
you could blame the other guy.
If
you get punked, right?
They always talk about that shit. Like, someone loses a game and they got like 1,000 memes of them losing.
Right.
Made by losers.
Yeah.
Like, you guys are fucking losers making memes.
Yeah.
At your shit job. You're going to talk about Manny Pacquiao getting planked or fucking Tom Brady losing a Super Bowl. He's got 5 fucking rings. He's got five. You work at a warehouse somewhere, bro. Like, fucking, yo, boss your life up. Quit clowning motherfuckers, man. You're a secretary for an accountant. Get the fuck out of here. Like, you're gonna make a meme? Yeah. Fuck you, dude.
Hey, you know, it's something people can do.
Fuck them. It's bad. I think it's bad for, I think but, that but shit it, is bad.
Well, I agree that it's bad, and but I think it's a, you know, the story that we're telling ourselves right now is that everybody has a voice, and that, you know, you can, that self-expression is not, is available to everybody, right?
Yeah, but like, yeah.
It probably shouldn't be.
Everyone does have a voice, but we, like, and I'm coming from Jenny Jones, so they started me off. Like, people get pleasure in other people failing.
Yeah, for sure.
They just love that shit.
For sure.
And it's cool, but, like, I like watching people win, man, because I want to win.
Yeah.
And I, like, even fucking Kobe Bryant, I can't stand his ass. He gets every fucking call. But, like, I'm not, like, he's a fucking winner.
Right. For sure.
What am I going to do? Fucking winner. What am I going to do?
You tell a story about your grandma.
Yeah.
In the book. And, which I thought was a beautiful story. But the piece about, you said something about not wanting to let go of anger because you felt like that was all you had.
Yeah, that was a big, I think a lot of us use certain emotions. Look at Michael Jordan when he won that fucking, when he got inducted in the Hall of Fame. Mm. You would think that he fucking got denied the Hall of Fame. That speech was so angry.
I don't remember.
He was just, and he was still shit talking people from 30 years ago. I'm right. Like, bro, you won, man.
Right.
You got him. You won. But he couldn't. Right. That's what drove. That was one of the things that drove Michael Jordan. It was competition. It was anger. Yeah. And it got him places. And it's still with him to this day. So you can use many emotions to drive you.
Yeah.
Anger is a lower emotion, but it is an action emotion. Mm-hmm. If you can use that for action. And for me, anger was something that really drove me. Now, it's one of those deals where it's like, you have to, it'll kill you if you keep rolling around right. with that shit.
Right.
So it's like, how do you separate? Let's say anger's gas. I've been driving a car, a gas car, all my life. Mm. Like, I'm afraid to let go of that. I'm sure. Afraid to let go of it to keep pushing my vehicle. And the irony is, I don't know if it's irony, but like the funny thing is like, you know, I felt shunned when I dropped this book, and guess what's fucking, guess why I'm fucking pushing? I'm mad.
Yeah.
Simon Schuster passed on me. HBO fucking didn't want me anymore.
Yeah.
I got passed on by publishers where my first book outsold all their books. And I got passed on by them. Mm-hmm. So you don't think for one minute that like fucking, like I got a chip, I don't have a chip on my shoulder, I do. I'm also joyful and grateful, but like, there is a part of me that sure. wants to be like, there's two parts. There's one part where I'm like, I need this to get out for people to fucking not feel so alone.
Right.
People with depression to not feel so fucking crazy. And the other part is like, I wanna fucking shove.
Of course.
I wanna shove it down their fucking throats, man. Yeah. Like, it's kinda crazy. It's like this dual thing. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you ever get like that, but like,
Sometimes I wish I would get more like that, because I think there is power in that.
To a certain extent.
And like my personal, like, I still have that sort of hood mentality from growing up of like, fuck them.
Right.
Like before they even can fuck me.
Yeah.
Fuck them. So right. I don't care.
Yeah.
Which is really not true. Like I recognize that.
Yeah, we all want to be loved, like right. deep down.
And
you know,
that's the story I'm telling myself as a cop out.
Right.
To avoid rejection, whatever.
Totally, but, I get it.
But I think you know when you can tap into that, and I think that's the point is like, you know, too much of anything is a problem. If your whole life is driven by anger,
yes,
you're probably gonna be in prison, or dead or
cancer or fucking a goddamn stroke. Or
absolutely.
Yeah.
But there is a time to tap into that and to use it as fuel, right?
Yes.
And the same with every emotion, right? That is finding the right balance and the right time to pull those triggers.
You're fucking right, dude. The shitty thing too for me is like I'm Italian, so like people think I'm fucking mad when I'm not. Like I'm not even fucking mad, dude. I'm just it's just the way I talk. We're abrasive. We're a fucking. I come from a fucking very loud, abrasive, in your face fucking family.
So I spent a month in Germany this summer, and I was, the whole time I was wondering what I did wrong. Everybody's
fucking Germans, dude. Yeah, dude. You're like, whoa, man. And they're giant. They're all fucking, I got like German homies. I feel like, when I hang out with them, I feel like they're my uncles. You know what I mean? Like, I'm always looking up to them. It's fucking ridiculous.
That's hilarious. All right, I got to do a lightning round before we get kicked out of here.
Let's get it, bro.
First of all, is there any favorite story in the book that I haven't touched on?
Well, you know, like, I love the last two, I think the last two stories in the book really tie everything together. Quite well. So those two I'm very fond of. I also like Blown. You guys should definitely check that out. That was one of the wilder teenage stories.
Yeah.
Being wild teenager. It's about white privilege. You guys will love it. And then
nice. All right, lightning round.
Okay.
Tell me one decision that changed your life forever.
One decision that changed my life forever, going on Jenny Jones. I was gonna be I was a window cleaner, and I was gonna go to junior college and then attempt to be a teacher. Mm. And now here I am.
What would you have taught?
Kindergarten, try to fuck the single moms.
Sure.
I thought, this is an 18-year-old. This is like, what can I do? I was like, all right, look, man, I'm a white dude, but I don't got connections.
Right.
So it's not like they're just gonna fucking bring me in somewhere. So where do I, in my 18-year-old brain, like, where do I have a fucking advantage? Fucking teaching. They need more men.
Right.
And then I was like, well, then I can fuck the moms, dude. Like, what the fuck? This is awesome.
I wanted to be a tennis pro and fuck the married moms.
You're a G.
See, but I didn't know how to play tennis.
Man, but like,
it never happened. See, but there was that movie, Jonathan Silverman, I think. Movie. Every idea I've ever had came from a movie.
It's a goddamn. See, you have higher aspirations than me already. You're trying to fuck rich women. I'm trying to fuck some rejected mother. I can't get fucking child support. She's like fucking chasing down her old man for child support.
Compete.
Little fucking asshole kid named Jaden. Like, Jesus Christ, that's good, bro.
Complete this sentence for yourself. I don't have talent, I have blank.
I don't have talent, I have drive. It's that old thing, man.
Yeah.
You know, I have creative thinking. Problem solving.
Nice.
Yeah.
So if I worked for you, you mentioned some encounters at work. What's something I would hear you say over and over?
Good job. I tell everybody, good job. Thanks, man. Good job. You're doing it. Like, I appreciate cats. I do. I really do.
That's big.
Yeah. Good job. Thanks, man. Every day.
Yeah.
And then if you fuck up, I'll be like, hey, man, we need to do this better this way. Mm-hmm. And if you do that 15 times, I'll probably call you a fucking dumbass.
Fair enough.
I think so. You know what I mean? Like, you fuck up 15 fucking times. If you fuck up more than 3 times on the same thing, like, what are we here for, man? How, now you're stealing money. That's the way I look at it now. Now you're a fucking thief.
I just read some bullshit that there's $100 billion in wages spent on people that aren't working.
I believe that.
Like the people, the time that people are wasting.
I believe that. I look around and sometimes I'm like, why are you even here, bro? Like, and the crazy thing is half their jobs are justifying having a job.
Yeah, sure.
Well, you should do this. Like, bitch, sure. You don't need your fucking input here. Like, when my shit got picked up by Simon Schuster, like, they started rearranging fonts and shit. I sold 10,000 without you, dude. Like, fuck you. Like, this is good. Print it the way it is.
Amazing.
Somebody needs to fucking justify their fucking salary. Whatever.
Who would you be most excited to learn as a fan of your work?
Man, you know what? I'll be real, real with you. Dan Carlin from Hardcore History. I love this guy's podcast.
Okay.
I feel like a weird pariah in that, like, a lot of the people who I really enjoy listening to, I think would actually hate my work. Isn't that fucking shitty? But whatever, you know, I listen to like a lot of, you know, I love Dan Carlin's Hardcore History. I love his take on history. It's a podcast. I hate to plug another podcast on your podcast, but like that's my guy.
He did that all the time.
He did a fucking like 9-hour series on the fucking Mongols.
Yeah. Really?
Those guys are fucking beasts, dude.
Oh yeah, for sure.
They was whooping ass for a fucking he made Hitler look like a bitch, man. He took out millions of motherfuckers, sure. Well, you know, Stalin, Mao made them. No one ever talks about that shit, you know. No one talks about the fucking 30 million motherfuckers Mao fucking just demolished.
You know,
it's not as sexy.
We like our villains. We like to pick our villains carefully.
Hey, I'm gonna be real with you. Like, them Nazis, they had the outfits and the fucking... Exactly. They had
better branding.
Yo, their branding was fucking... Their branding killed Supreme. You know what I mean? Like, their branding killed Supreme. Nazis' branding was fucking stupid dumb, dude. I think fucking Hugo Boss was designing their shit. Like, they were like, yeah, bro, here. Fucking handle that.
Yeah.
Yeah, what else? Sorry. I don't know how we got on a fucking Nazi rant.
It's funny because I read that recently and, you know, people were mad at Hugo Boss or whatever. But, like, first of all, I don't know what that dude was all about. But
what would you do?
That's what I'm saying. What are you gonna say? No.
Would you gonna say no to Hitler? You live there, like right. What do you need, bro? Like, where you want me the lapel here? Okay, it'll be all right. Great, 2-inch lapel. I got you. You're not gonna do a fucking thing. The same people that are talking that shit are afraid to ask their boss for a fucking raise. You gonna tell Hitler no? Yeah, right, motherfucker.
Right.
You bitch. That's the problem I have with people. A lot of people look at history through these lenses right now, from like the comfort of Western society with everything that has gotten them here, and then they fucking talk about what they would or would not have done.
That's the whole, that whole Make America Great Again thing is that, right? It's people saying, we want to go back to this 15-year, 20-year slice of time, right?
Yes.
Back in their minds, right? Because there's a whole bunch of reality that is not the way that people remember it. But nonetheless, what that is saying is like, we liked the 50s when white folks could...
I disagree with this whole fucking premise, dude.
Well, what I'm saying?
Yeah, I really do. I just disagree with it. I think maybe for some people that is, but I couldn't tell you what Hillary Clinton's fucking...
But
what I'm saying is, and like, I don't know what Hillary Clinton's fucking policies are.
I don't either.
He was saying, hey, bro, we're shitty now. Let's try to get, we weren't shitty back then. It wasn't about the white this or white. It was like, yo, dude, we had jobs. There was more factories.
Yeah.
Like,
we're saying the same thing.
But you brought race into it. So that's where I'm kind of like, eh.
We could leave that out, although I think if we looked at whether black people had good paying jobs at that time, I think...
Black people had better paying... Black people were doing better before the Civil Rights Movement, to be quite frank with you. Go look at the fucking...
I don't know, so I'm not going to argue that.
Yeah, Fair enough. I looked at economists. I'm not saying that the fucking... I'm not saying that there shouldn't be a civil rights movement.
Maybe I threw race in when I shouldn't.
I wish you wouldn't, because that's enough. All I ever hear is fucking race out here.
The point I'm trying to make, though, is different, is that for thousands of years, most people were born, suffered, and died.
You are right. I agree with you on that.
And then, wholeheartedly. And then all of a sudden...
We had a 20-year...
We had this fucking great...
Yes.
And the trend is shifting, right? And I'm not... I would say for some better, some worse... The trend is shifting. It's not what it used to be.
I agree. I think we're on the same page. It's just I get so triggered by like fucking white man.
Okay,
like I go to parties and I get shit on by fucking white women talking about white man, white man, white man. I'm like, bitch, you are living off of a white man, your father, so shut the fuck up.
That's a good point.
Oh, you owe the patriarchy. You hate that shit until it's time for your cell phone to get paid. Huh. Fucking bitch. Like I had to work my ass off to get to this fucking party.
That's right.
Where you can shit on me. Fuck you, man.
What is your favorite city to travel to?
I don't know. Nashville's fun. I've been like in Nashville, and I like going home, too.
Yeah.
I love going home. And here's the other thing about the whole Make America Great Again. Like, the middle class, like, it's pretty easy to be middle class when the rest of the world is destroyed.
Well, that's why. Yeah. That's why that window of time.
Yeah, we were crushing.
Yeah,
like,
because Europe was fucking demolished.
Obliterated. Japan got blew the fuck up.
Absolutely.
China got fucked up by Japan.
The whole world got fucked up.
And here we are. Yeah.
And then there's the Marshall Plan, whatever the policies that kind of, you know, prohibited those guys from building armies.
And look,
you know,
at
we had this unfair advantage for a certain period of time.
Yeah.
Cats great
caught
for
up.
Us that we did.
Yep.
But it's a really short-sighted view of history to think that that's supposed to be the normal or the standard that we hold ourselves to.
I agree with you. And I agree with that.
The GI Bill, yes. Right, so that the government was paying for people to go to college, which now we don't want to do.
But if you look, well, I guess my point was, if you look at a lot of the swing states, counties that voted for Obama went to, and Obama was what, hope, right?
Yeah.
They went to Trump.
Yeah.
Like, so.
No, I totally agree. There was a clear platform.
So
it was a much better branding, better slogan.
It was like, well, it kind of like, yeah, sure. I'm sure that, like, I'm not saying that there's not racism in America. There's racism fucking everywhere. But I think people are missing the point of this election if they blame it on racism and sexism solely, because it is.
Yes.
It's bigger than that.
Sure.
Because Obama got a lot of the same votes that Trump got.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lot of Democrats didn't show up to vote either. The black vote was down 7%.
Yeah.
It's a big percent. It's damn near 10%.
Yeah.
Like, these are all facts that aren't stated. But they'll say, oh, fucking sexist. Like, maybe she just wasn't fucking charming. I don't know. Yeah. Maybe people don't trust her. Who the fuck knows? Mm-hmm. I don't know. I've never voted for a winner in my whole entire life. Ever.
Well, I do think it's a big oversimplification to say, you know, that to look at the one difference between them is gender. Like, that's ridiculous. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think fucking, like, this is me just fucking speculating, but I bet Michelle Obama would have had a better chance of fucking Hillary Clinton.
I think you're right. And just as I think there were some people that would never in their lives vote for a black president, Obama got elected. There's some people that would never in their lives vote for a woman. Doesn't mean that. So sexism exists, racism exists. That doesn't mean that that's what caused these things to
happen. But also, like, Obama got many votes simply for his race. What is that? You know what I mean? Like,
for sure.
So it's just like, dude, like, people vote on that.
Yeah.
People vote on that. But, and people vote on gender. I'm not denying that there's somebody out there that, like,
no doubt.
Said, I don't want a woman as my president, but I don't think that that was the fucking tipping. I don't think that that was really the big thing. Maybe she could have showed up in Wisconsin and other swing states to fucking
try to get a vote.
Yeah, I
think there's
a
lot of strategy errors.
Yo, when you have more Democrats than fucking Republicans and they keep whooping your ass, maybe it's time to look in the mirror and maybe you're, like, not that fucking good as a fucking third party person. I'm just throwing that out there.
What's the last?
I don't trust the government, y'all. So that's my vote. I don't trust that shit, and I'm not waiting for them to save me. I just want them to stay the fuck out of my way while I'm trying to go get it.
That's right.
That's it. Quit taxing me. I got to step over fucking bum piss and fucking knocked out people, and I got a 10% tax in this fucking goddamn state. What the fuck are you doing with my money, dude?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
What is the last great book you read?
How'd you get me in fucking politics, for fuck's sake?
I don't know
man.
How to happen.
You, motherfucker, MAGA. Let me, it's MAGA and white men. Fucking, that all came out in one sentence.
What is the last great book you read?
Fuck, dude. I haven't read a book in a really long time because I find it extremely hard to read right now. It's really weird. I'm taking in my... I love Larry McMurtry. He wrote Lonesome Dove and that series. He does a lot of like westerns that I really like. I think his dialogue is great. I just love his dialogue. There's a series, I forgot the name, I think it's like The Black Crimson or some shit like that by this dude, Brent Weeks. It's a series, it's not finished yet. It's like about color bending, like people can control colors, and it's like medieval fantasy type shit, and that one was pretty fire too. Those are the two. Nice. Larry McMurtry, Brent Weeks. It's his Brent Weeks' newest project.
Yeah. What movie have you seen the most in your life?
Fuck, dude, I don't know, man. Like, you know, I'm Italian, so it's like Godfather, Goodfellas, all that whoppy shit, dude. Yeah. Fucking Casino, goddamn Menace, Boys in the Hood, Blood In, Blood Out, I'd watch the fuck out of. I love all that gangster shit, but surprisingly, Princess Bride is my shit. Uh-huh. Big Lebowski, I used to go to sleep to. Harry Potter 2, I used to fucking love that shit. Okay. Love fucking Harry Potter 2. You're like, what was the movie? And I was like 20 fucking movies. Those are the movies that I fuck with. And then the last movie that came out that I saw that I really dug was Good Time. I don't know if you're familiar with it, and I didn't even realize it. The guy from Twilight's in it.
And I don't know it.
It's just like a little fucking, you know, indie. As an indie is like $30 million. It's an indie flick. Right. It's an indie flick. It's cool. Great soundtrack.
Okay.
Just, I dug it. I thought it was a solid movie.
I'm gonna check it out.
Yeah, you should, bro. I think you would dig it.
Read The Godfather.
I did. Chick had a big pussy. Who knew?
Isn't it like, you know, because I've seen that movie right. dozens of times.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I'm sure you have. And then reading it was a whole different experience.
And, you know, like the characters are way different than, like, Sonny's a different kind of guy. And, isn't that funny how that goes?
So great.
So here's a story. I forgot the guy's name. There was an actor that actually got the part of Sonny, but he was so much taller than Al Pacino that he lost that part.
Oh, really?
And he went on to obscurity.
Yeah.
And that was that for him.
Well, you know, like, so you ever saw The Kid Stays in the Picture or read that book?
They might have touched on it in there.
Maybe. So they, you know, they didn't want Pacino for that role.
Who'd they want?
Somebody famous. Right. He was nobody. And his agent passed on the role because he was supposed to be in the gang that couldn't shoot straight.
Word.
Filming at the same time. And then Bob Evans went around the agent and got to Pacino and got him to do... You know, the agent didn't want to, like, upset the studio and fuck up his own relationships.
Right.
So Bob Evans went around him, got him for that role, and, you know, that's history.
Fucking bananas, dude.
Crazy. But the book is so good. I'm about to read The Fortunate Pilgrim, which was...
Was that another one of his books?
The book he wrote before The Godfather. So he wrote these few books that were, like, critically acclaimed, but he couldn't sell any book. He couldn't make a living.
Huh.
So then he wrote The Godfather to be his, like, commercial thing.
Fucking work. Yeah. Did he write like The Sicilian or some shit like that? Yep. I remember reading a lot of those in high school, man. We read more back then. You know what I mean? Like we had less shit to do. So like, I'm fucking read a goddamn book.
Yeah, yeah.
No, Godfather, Eldridge Cleaver, motherfucking all that shit. Uh-huh. Like I love it. I think that's just kind of like, I'm just trying to get motherfuckers to read again because you're taking in you're involved in the way you take in your information, and because of that, your brain works differently.
Yeah,
that's just the way it goes. Right now, we passively take in our information, and you can tell by the way we think.
For sure. Who's your favorite DJ?
My favorite DJ. I grew up listening to a DJ called the Electrifying Mojo.
Uh huh.
He was on 107.5, and that was And he was like an honorary member of Funkadelic, and he broke Prince, and he played Funkadelic, and it felt like he was late at night, and it felt like you were on a spaceship with him, dude. And I think it was this really intimate feeling that he created. Mm. And then second favorite is, his name escapes me. Who's the white motherfucker that be doing all the shout outs on LA radio?
Oh. Felly Fell?
No, dude, he's old as shit. He'd be like, this one goes out from little...
Art LeBeau.
Art LeBeau is my motherfucking dude, man. Art LeBeau is a beast. I love Art LeBeau.
Yeah.
I love that Art LeBeau is this guy that is this fucking old-ass white dude.
He's in his 80s.
yeah, he's this old ass white dude, fucking sounds corny as fuck, but like is true to himself. And that mother, you could drop him off in any fucking hood on the West Coast and with $1,000 around his neck, and that motherfucker be good. As long as there's some 30-year-olds enough around.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, don't let the teenagers see him. I don't know if they don't know about Art LeBeau, but man, that motherfucker is I love Art LeBeau.
He's amazing, and he reminds me of you a little bit in the sense of like his voice stands out in the environment or in what he's talking about.
Yes.
Because he's kind of like the opposite. Like, you know, he has a grandpa, old man voice.
Yeah.
But he's giving a shout out from Little Puppet.
Yeah,
who
dude.
Just got out of the pen, so whatever.
This goes out to Joker.
Yeah.
from Tweety Bird.
But, you know, that's also that East L.A., like, love you know, it. My family's from East L.A. They're all Jewish, and they grew up, it was Jews and Mexicans.
Yeah.
And, you know, working class people.
I remember that was such a culture shock to me because I'm Detroit, so we don't have like we got a Mexican community, but not like LA.
Not like
so like I went to like a old school soul concert, and like you go to an old school soul concert, and it's like brothers in fucking purple fucking giant suits and gaiters and shit like that. And then I came to one out here, it was all cholos. Yeah. I'm like, it broke my fucking brain.
Yeah.
Same with the Smiths. I went to like a Smiths appreciation.
Smith shit out here is crazy.
Yeah, I like it. It's weird. It was a different culture. I wasn't used to it when I first came out here.
Yeah.
Like I just didn't understand it. Like it's a different culture, man. Like cultures are different.
For sure.
And I remember like being at a fucking 7-Eleven deep in the valley somewhere, and it was kind of a hood, and this dude's looking at me. So this Mexican cat's looking at me, kind of a hood ass dude. He's looking at me, and I'm, you know, I'm like, hey, what's up, man? He's like, what's up, man? I'm like, you good, man? And like, I don't know, are we like in a fucking fight or a hug or what? Like, am I supposed to hit you with something? Or I couldn't tell if we was having
you don't know if he's on ecstasy or angel dust.
I couldn't tell if we was having a confrontation or not, dude. Like, it was like at the end of fucking, you ever had your shit pushed in? You know what I mean? Like, it was like the end of fucking training day. I was like, what the fuck is this? I'm just used to motherfuckers being like, fuck you, bitch. You know what I mean? Like, real aggressive. Like, his shit was like this weird passive aggressive smiley shit. I'm like, man, y'all playing some mental chess I'm not used to, bro. Like, let me just get my 5-hour energy drink and bail, man. Let me get this water in fucking peace. I don't know what the fuck is going on.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, it was a while ago. I don't go to the valley like that no more.
All right, they're going to kick us out of here, but everybody needs to read Hummingbird. That shit is incredible.
Check it out, man. Even if you don't agree with me, like, you shouldn't agree with everything I say, but because we all have different opinions, but this is like,
this I just is, think there's great stories, and some make you laugh, some will make you want to cry, some will make you sad.
Yeah,
they'll all, you know, they'll touch you in different ways, which is which we need that today.
Yo, dude, I was trying to be like Pac, bro. Like, I'm not a thug. I'm not a tough guy, but I grew up around a lot of that shit. And if you look at how Pac writes his songs and shit, like, he's not writing about selling dope every song, but motherfuckers that sell dope really relate to that shit.
Yeah, for sure.
So like, I wanted to Pac that shit, man. That was like my goal. I wanted to Pac that shit.
That's what I wrote on the review.
Thanks for writing a review, man. I appreciate that.
Of course.
Thank you, man.
But I said, not knowing we were going to have this conversation, I said, you know, some of the reviews call him the new Bukowski. I think he's the new Tupac.
Fucking A, dude.
That's real.
High five.
Fucking A. My man, I hope you sell hella books. I hope you keep writing, because I can't wait to read the next one.
Thank you. If you guys are looking at the camera, I'm literally like rubbing my eyes. I'm like, sell hella books. It's selling's harder than writing.
I'm sure.
But yo, it's a fun process both ways.
I'm sure.
Thank you, man.
Jude, thanks for doing this.
My man.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that. That was a wild one. I know I did. Let us know what you think. Hit us up on Twitter, on Facebook with a comment. Check out our YouTube videos. It's all at Rebel Radio Net. Leave us a review on iTunes if you would. I'd appreciate that. And most importantly, come back next week for more Rebel Radio.